With Tesla's recent purchase of Maxwell Technologies, I thought it was the perfect time to take a closer look at the current state of batteries and what could be next, as well as what supercapacitors are and why so many people are excited by them, and a wonder material that could change everything. So we're all familiar with lithium-ion batteries. They power pretty much everything in our lives at this point, from the cell phone in your pocket, to your laptop, smartwatch, wireless earphones, remote controls, electric vehicles, and more. But when did they actually become a thing? John Goodenough is recognized as the inventor of the lithium cobalt oxide cathode in 1980, which was then introduced to the world by Sony in 1991. Ever since then, lithium-ion batteries have become the standard for powering almost all consumer electronics. The same thing that makes them so efficient and versatile is also the thing that can make them dangerous. We've all seen the reports of what can happen when a lithium-ion battery goes bad. A lithium-ion battery is made up of a positive and a negative side. The positive is the cathode, which is most often made up of a lithium cobalt oxide, and the negative is the anode, which is made up of carbon, which is most often graphite, and graphite's going to make a reappearance a little later in the video. The use of graphite helps to produce a flat voltage curve on discharge. And the reason lithium is used is that it's the lightest metal and can also absorb a lot of electrons. Those two sides are then submerged in a liquid electrolyte and are separated by a microperforated separator, which allows only the ions to pass through. When the battery charges, the ions pass from the cathode to the anode, and when the battery discharges, the ions flow in reverse back to the cathode. Every time you use your cell phone and recharge it, those ions are flowing back and forth with each cycle. The reason a battery can explode is that metal can build up during this process on the cathode side and slowly create stalactite-like growths, which are known as dendrites. And those can extend and puncture the separator. And that's when you get exploding batteries. So as great as lithium batteries are at giving us all of the amazing mobile technologies that power our lives, it has some dangerous downsides if they aren't properly engineered or dropped, punctured, or otherwise not properly cared for. Not to mention the downsides of mining for lithium and cobalt, which have impacts on the environment, and in some cases, human rights abuses in some mines. This leads me to Maxwell Technologies' innovation that probably led them to getting purchased by Tesla, dry battery electrodes. This shouldn't be confused with solid-state batteries, which is something I'll cover later. Dry battery electrodes is an innovation in the manufacturing process of the anode and the cathode that doesn't require any liquid solvent in the process. Usually the materials are sprayed on with solvents that then have to be dried or baked off. The solvents in process create off-gassing and pollution, so Maxwell's dry electrode process actually improves the ecological side of battery production. But the biggest benefits are around energy density, battery life, and cost. Batteries using this method show greater than 300 watt-hours per kilogram, with a path to over 500 watt-hours per kilogram. By comparison, Tesla's current battery technology, which is considered one of the highest densities available today, is believed to be around 230 watt-hours per kilogram. That means this technique could add about 23% to Tesla's current battery density with room to double it. This could lead to vehicles with significantly more range. And the batteries are also showing improved durability with battery life almost doubling. Companies like Tesla typically warranty their batteries for 8 years. Again, this could lead expected battery pack longevity to be much, much longer. And finally, another big reason that Tesla probably purchased Maxwell is the cost reduction. Since this process doesn't require large drying areas, there's a 16 times production capacity density increase and 10 to 20% cost reduction versus the wet electrode method. The bottom line is, it's going to be cheaper to manufacture much better batteries. And that brings us to solid-state batteries and the race to bring them to market. The basic format of a solid-state battery is just like a lithium-ion battery. You have a cathode and an anode and an electrolyte. But instead of a liquid, it's a solid. And I'm sure you didn't see that one coming. The exact chemistry and materials used is where there's a race between various researchers and companies. Here in Massachusetts is one of those companies, Ionic Materials. They have working prototypes of a solid-state battery that they're trying to bring to market. Without a liquid electrolyte, they're exceptionally safe and don't explode when compromised. You can drive a nail through a solid-state battery like this, or even cut it in half as it's being used, and it will still continue to work. No fire, no explosion. They also have higher energy densities than standard lithium-ion batteries, which means you can use much smaller batteries to achieve the same power storage on products that we use today. Smaller batteries means fewer materials and lower production costs. And this is where John Goodenough makes a reappearance with his co-author Maria Helena Braga and their glass battery. At 95 years old, John Goodenough is still researching battery chemistries to replace lithium-ion batteries with something better, faster, safer, and ecologically sound. The glass battery doesn't use cobalt, and the lithium could eventually be replaced with easily accessible sodium. That means these batteries could be biodegradable at some point. As you probably guessed from the nickname, it uses a glass-like electrolyte that can last for more than 23,000 charge and discharge cycles, which is more than a minor improvement over several thousand for a typical lithium-ion cell. There's still some debate from battery researchers around Goodenough and Braga's findings, but Goodenough's credentials as one of the inventors of the lithium-ion battery add a lot of credibility to the findings. So with major advancements like that in lithium battery production, we're done, right? The problem solved. Well, not exactly. Lithium batteries offer tremendous amounts of energy density, but they're not great at power density. If you need a huge burst of power, say for an EV's acceleration or a grid-scale battery system reacting to a sudden demand, lithium-ion batteries aren't the best option. This is where supercapacitors come in, since they have a huge power density. Where batteries are slower electrochemical reactions that generate electricity, supercapacitors are electrostatic. It's basically static electricity. A conventional capacitor is made up of two conductive materials separated by a thin insulating material. Apply a current and a positive charge builds up on one side and a negative charge on the other. No electrolytes needed, which makes them safer and more durable. They're also able to transfer a massive amount of power almost instantly, which is more appropriate for something like an EV and would allow for charging in seconds or minutes. And they have a much greater recharge cycle lifespan than batteries. The reason we don't use capacitors, though, is that they don't have a good energy density. The current technology can only hold about 10 watt hours per kilogram, or about 5% of a typical lithium-ion battery. You would need an absolutely massive supercapacitor pack to equal what you get in a relatively small lithium-ion battery pack. If only we could combine supercapacitor power with lithium-ion battery energy density, imagine what we could do then. You knew where I was going with that one, right? This is where the wonder material makes its introduction. Say hello to graphene. Graphene is a thin crystalline layer of carbon at one atom thick. The best way to think of it is it's essentially an ultra-thin layer of graphite. Now, I told you graphite would make a reappearance, so get your number two pencils ready. What makes graphene different is that its atoms are arranged in a honeycomb pattern, a one atom thick honeycomb pattern. This makes graphene not only an amazing two-dimensional object, but also one of the strongest materials ever known. This one atom thick material is 100 times stronger than steel. Research is showing that it could be the next silicon, helping to create faster electronics, dramatically more efficient solar panels, and could even become one of the best ways to purify water. It really is earning the wonder material nickname. Highly conductive, strong, flexible, and transparent. It has a multitude of uses that could revolutionize pretty much everything. And that leads me to the potential future of a supercapacitor made from graphene that has the qualities of energy-dense batteries with the immense power capabilities of capacitors. A recent breakthrough at the Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory has created a 3D printed graphene aerogel scaffold that was loaded with a capacitive material into that scaffolding and achieved the most energy storage ever in a capacitor. Imagine phones, laptops, and cars able to charge in seconds to a few minutes, and virtually no degradation from recharge cycles. Lithium-ion batteries may be the reigning champion, but supercapacitors may eventually replace batteries as we know them. This wasn't a comprehensive list of all the different technologies and research being done into energy storage. There's a lot more out there, like flow batteries, fuel cells, and much more. But when you focus in on just a couple of areas, you can see how quickly things are changing. We're not going to have cell phones that can charge in seconds in the next few years, as much as we may want that. But you can see what might be a little further down the road. There's not a straight path from here to there, but there are important incremental updates being made along the way, like Maxwell Technologies' dry battery electrodes. Now, if you're someone who knows a lot about this topic or is involved in this kind of research and technology, please share any details I missed that could help clarify things down in the comments. And if you like this video, be sure to give it a thumbs up and comment about whether you think supercapacitors are going to become the new battery. And if you'd like to support the channel, there are some ways to do so. Want some fun, geeky t-shirts? Check out my SFSF shop for some cool Tesla, SpaceX, science, and Undecided shirts. Every purchase helps to support the channel. And get some great Tesla accessories like console wraps, LED lights, and more from Abstract Ocean and save 15% off your first order with my referral code. And a big shout out to one of the new Patreon Supporter Plus members, Brian Glover. Thanks so much for joining and supporting the channel. You can also become an Undecided supporter on Patreon to help grow and shape the channel. If you're interested, please go check out my Patreon page for additional details, and I hope to see some of you over there. And if you haven't already, consider subscribing and hitting the notification bell to get alerts when I post new videos. And as always, thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.